On this island, you're only allowed to live. Being born or dying here is forbidden. Walking around without a weapon, locking your car, or keeping a pet cat are also forbidden. This is Svalbard, a place where polar bears outnumber people, where minus 30 degrees Celsius is considered normal, and where scientific research never stops. Depression rates here are high, because for two whole months in winter, all you see is darkness. The island is also home to the famous Doomsday Vault, buried 130 meters deep inside a mountain. One thing connects all of these: the Arctic conditions. Even though it's under the sovereignty of the Kingdom of Norway, the Svalbard Treaty allows citizens of more than 40 countries to settle, work, and trade here, as long as they get approval from the governor. Svalbard's story begins in 1596, when Dutch explorer Willem Barents discovered the islands while searching for a new sea route. He named it Spitsbergen, meaning pointed mountains. That discovery marked the start of a long era of hunting. For European powers, this frozen archipelago became a haven for whaling and seal hunting. There were no permanent settlements yet, but every summer, the coastline filled with the temporary camps of sailors chasing fortune. By the late 1800s, people realized the islands were rich in underground resources. This time, Americans and Norwegians entered the picture. Coal mining began, and permanent buildings were constructed. Later, the Soviets came and opened their own mines. With so many countries operating in the region, conflicts started to rise. After World War I, the Svalbard Treaty was signed in 1925. Norway was granted full and official sovereignty over the islands, but not in the usual way. This principle of equality is still upheld today. Norway cannot impose heavy taxes in Svalbard, and all revenue collected must be used solely for the islands. As a result, Svalbard has lower taxes compared to the rest of Norway. This also means residents don't get full access to Norway's social benefits, like pensions, welfare, or unemployment support. No country, not even Norway, can use Svalbard for military purposes. This clause became especially important during the Cold War. Despite being part of NATO member Norway, Soviet mining towns existed side by side with Western settlements. Svalbard became a frozen island of peace, where East and West coexisted during one of the world's most divided eras. Climate change, glacier movements, the northern lights, microorganisms, atmospheric monitoring systems. Today, climate crisis, ecosystem shifts, and global warming are the main focus areas of research in Svalbard. The reason? While global temperatures have risen by an average of 1.2 degrees Celsius, in Svalbard, the increase is between 4 to 6 degrees Celsius. Scientists call this place the front line of climate change. That's why researchers from all over the world are drawn to these frozen islands. Countries like Norway, Germany, France, China, Japan, South Korea, and Russia have all established research stations here. Svalbard is preparing for a global disaster. The Svalbard Global Seed Vault stores seeds from around the world. Approximately 1 million seed varieties are kept at minus 18 degrees Celsius, deep inside a mountain. If a global catastrophe strikes, humanity could restart agriculture using the seeds stored here. The vault opened in 2008, but planning began as early as 1983. It's designed to survive even a nuclear explosion and cost around $9 million. It's located in Spitsbergen, just like most of Svalbard's other key structures. Today, around 2,700 people live in Svalbard. Most are Norwegian, followed by Russians. There are also people from Poland, Germany, China, India, and the US. The main industries are mining, scientific research, and tourism. Svalbard is home to some of the cleanest air on the planet, and its main settlement, Longyearbyen, is considered the world's northernmost town. Over 60% of Svalbard is covered in permanent glaciers. Beneath the surface, the ground remains frozen almost all year round. This means buried bodies don't decompose. In the 1920s, exhumed graves revealed corpses in nearly perfect condition. Worse still, some bodies from the 1918 Spanish flu pandemic still carried traces of the virus. posing a serious biological risk. As a result, burials in Svalbard were banned. Today, if someone is terminally ill or near death, they are flown to mainland Norway. Even the official cemetery is no longer in use. Outside the towns, there's always a chance of running into a polar bear. It's estimated that around 3,000 polar bears live in the region. These apex predators can blend into their icy surroundings and silently approach their prey. That's why carrying a firearm is mandatory outside settlements. But using the weapon isn't so simple. Harming a bear is an absolute last resort. If you injure or kill one, you'll face a serious investigation. The bear's life is considered almost equal to yours. That's why most people carry flare guns and noise devices instead. To stay safe from polar bears, cars and some buildings must remain unlocked. In an emergency, anyone should be able to find shelter quickly. Technically, giving birth in Longyearbyen isn't illegal, but in practice, it's not allowed. Medical services are limited. In case of early labor or complications, there's very little that can be done. So pregnant women are sent to mainland Norway a few weeks before their due date. Svalbard is also a critical breeding ground for many Arctic bird species, including endangered ones. Since cats threaten bird populations, owning a cat is banned. Even building a house here comes with rules. You can't place buildings directly on the ground. The heat from a house could melt the permafrost and cause the structure to collapse. That's why all buildings are raised off the ground on stilts. Infrastructure is also designed for the climate. Water and sewage pipes run above ground, not below, to avoid bursting in the frozen soil. Svalbard must import almost everything. There's no local production, no real farming, and barely any livestock. So how does life continue here? All supplies, food, fuel, materials, electronics, are brought in from mainland Norway. In summer, cargo ships make deliveries, but in winter, the sea freezes, making ship traffic impossible. During those months, only airplanes can reach Longyearbyen. They carry both passengers and small cargo, but flights can be canceled due to weather. As you can imagine, food brought by plane is expensive. Meat, fruit, milk, and bread are costly. Alcohol is also available, but there's a personal limit on how much you can buy, because in such isolation and darkness, alcohol dependency becomes a real risk. For 4 months in winter, the sun never rises. This is called the polar night. To stay mentally healthy, people seek therapy, gather in always open cafes, and engage in indoor sports. At home, UV lamps are used to meet vitamin D needs. Sleep cycles get disrupted, and many start measuring time not by the clock, but by how they feel. In summer, it's the opposite. The sun doesn't set. Sleep becomes difficult, but energy and productivity spike. Here's another unusual rule. Being homeless is illegal. If someone doesn't have a place to stay, they're sent back to the mainland. Because being homeless in this cold is equivalent to a death sentence. And perhaps the strangest tradition, you have to take off your shoes before entering buildings. This started with coal miners to avoid bringing coal dust into homes, but it's still practiced today. Whether it's a school or a government building, shoes come off at the door. In short, here being born, dying, and many other things are off limits. Just as different geographies demand different ways of living, the Arctic brings its own set of rules. Svalbard's strict regulations are, in a way, a peace treaty signed with nature. Svalbard used to be about hunting. Then it was about coal. Now, it's about the future. Not just by storing seeds for the generations to come, but through vital research on climate change, geology, space, and Arctic biology. It may be on the edge of the world, but perhaps it's closer to the heart of the future than we think. Thanks for watching. If you don't want to miss upcoming videos, make sure to subscribe and turn on the notifications. See you in the next video.